Hey brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. I hope you guys are doing all right. Just trying to make a video. I've been meaning to make a video. I've touched on this in the past, way back. And I know that most of the people who are on the internet looking at preaching, they're wanting to hear about the dreams and visions and the rapture and all that. And of course, you know, the Lord has given me many visions, many dreams. I would say 90% of the things that the Lord shows me, I do not share on the internet, brothers and sisters, because, you know, I've said this before, of course, I'm not on internet to win a popularity contest, and I'm not on here to tickle people's ears and entertain them, so you guys know how I am. And I want to talk to you, you know, in my ministry, and someone had asked me this, you know, about the, you know, prophet, and they think about prophet, they think about Jonah and Elijah and all that. That's true. You have your Old Testament prophets, and there's New Testament prophets. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, we see that there's really, it's really four, they say. The experts in Greek tell us there's really four, not the fivefold ministry. You hear people saying that. And, of course, that's, it doesn't really matter. They say that pastor and teacher go together. And even in the English, you'll see it in King James, it'll say apostle. He gave some apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers, it's kind of connected. So they say that in the Greek, the pastor and teacher are really the same thing, which would make sense, but it doesn't matter. It's not important. Anyhow, so in the New Testament prophet, I want to talk about that. There's the gifts of the Spirit, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and there's the gift of prophecy. And then the Bible tells us, as Paul says, that prophecy is the greatest and to covet to prophesy, unless you speak, if someone speaks in tongues and someone interprets, it's equal to prophecy. And that's what it is. It's a prophecy in the church. So those gifts of the Spirit, 1 Corinthians chapter 12 through 14, if someone speaks in tongues and someone interprets, that's a prophecy. It's like two nickels equals a dime, and then someone prophesying is a dime, just to, you know, kind of put it out there. So it takes those two together to equal the same thing as prophecy. Now, when we're talking about the gift of prophecy, you know, it's not the same as the office of a prophet. I made a video about videos about this way back a couple years ago. I'm just laying it out again as the Lord is leading me. So if someone says, well, in the New Testament, you know, prophecy is to exhort the church. The gift of prophecy that can be given by anybody, you know, it's supposed to be, you know, to churches in the Bible, there's no building, you know, it's just like a home church. You got a group of 20 or 30 people together maybe or something in somebody's house or whatever. Or, you know, an outdoor, like in, they met in Solomon's porch there in the temple, outer temple area there in the beginning of the book of Acts after Pentecost. And, you know, maybe there's hundreds or thousands. It talks about 3,000 people being saved. But they're preaching, and when you have your normal daily, you know, or your when you meet as the body of Christ, two or more gathered in my name, Jesus said, there I am in the midst of you. You know, it's supposed to be that, you know, someone, as Paul's telling us in that 1 Corinthians text that I've been talking about, the gifts of the Spirit, he says, you know, one, you know, has a word and somebody else, you know, has a song and all this. So, you know, we're supposed to participate. It's not supposed to be a one-man show anyway of someone preaching only. You know, now, even though there are times, like in, we have Sunday morning in churches, most churches, or if you go to a, you know, an evangelistic crusade at a baseball coliseum, yeah, there's a speaker in there giving a message to the world. Evangelism is to the lost. The problem in most churches, when they have what they call a so-called revival, they actually have an evangelist who's evangelizing the people that's been saved for 20 or 30 years. I mean, they're what they call, you know, preaching to the choir, you know, and that's what most churches call a crusade or a revival. They're really doing an evangelistic crusade in the church when really we need to do the evangelistic crusades out in the world. You know, out in the public places and in the marketplace, not inside the church in front, if it's all Christians already. But anyway, so there's the gift of prophecy that anybody can have. You know, if the Lord gives it to you, it says the Holy Spirit divides the gifts of the Spirit severally among us as he wills, it says in the King James. You know, and there's listed 9 different gifts, even though, you know, there's subcategories of that that are not listed. You know, and I could do a study of that. I've thought about doing it many times, going through the New Testament and then saying, oh, this is an example of A, this is an example of B. As an example, when I want to get into these examples, a word of knowledge, you know, like the man there, Ananias in Damascus, and when Paul, Saul of Tarsus, who is also Paul, was blinded, You know, the Lord Jesus appeared to him and said, hey, there's a guy named Saul of Tarsus who's in the street called Straight, you know, and I want you to go there and pray for him. So he got a word of knowledge. He knew where Saul was because the Lord told him. He didn't know on his own that Saul was there. He got a word of knowledge that Saul was there. Then he got a word of wisdom. I want you to pray for him, and I'm going to show him all the things he's got to suffer for me. So that's a word of wisdom. What's going to happen? A word of knowledge is, as an example, I always kind of switch gears here, but a word of knowledge is an example. If I was praying for you and the Lord told me, hey, the person you're praying with, they've got something wrong with their knee. They have a pain in their knee. You didn't tell me. The Lord told me, oh, you got a pain in your knee. So I say to you, oh, there's a pain in your knee. And you say, yeah. And then the Lord says, oh, I'm going to heal this person. I'm going to make this person's knee fixed, and then they're going to have a great, their knee is not going to bother them the rest of their life. So that's a word of wisdom, you know, that in the future, your knee's going to be healed. It's going to be healed, and then you're going to be having no more trouble with your knee. That's a word of wisdom, you know. Application of knowledge is, different examples of the word of wisdom is you know, you say to me, Brother Patrick, can you pray whether I should start this new business? I have lots of people asking me questions like that. Brother Patrick, should I start this new business, or what should I do? And the Lord says, you know, go start that business, or don't start that business, or wait. That's a word of wisdom. But if the Lord told me, hey, Brother so-and-so wants to start a business, that's a word of knowledge. The Lord told me you want to start a business. And then the word of wisdom is the Lord says, wait, don't do it now. See, these are examples. But there's the gifts of the Spirit that I'm just talking about, but then there's the office of a prophet. There's the prophetic gifts, word of wisdom, word of knowledge, and prophecy, tongues with interpretation. Those are all along the same line of prophetic gifts. You got gifts of healing and all that. Those are different. There's the power gifts, the revelation gifts, and I guess I need to do a video on the gifts of the spirits. The gifts of the Spirit, and then divide it up. But, you know, I need to go back and review all that stuff. It's been a while since I looked at all those details before I could get into it on here. But the office of a prophet is someone who operates as a preacher, and then they operate in those gifts on a regular basis. Prophecy, words of wisdom, words of knowledge, tongues with interpretation, and all that kind of stuff. That is, you know, and then they're doing it at a very high level compared to the, you know, just the average Christian who's not a preacher. See, so that's the difference. So all the different offices, they all proclaim. They can all do the work of an evangelist. They can all teach. They can all pastor. They can all, you know, an apostle, really, you know, biblical meaning, not the 12 apostles, but to be an apostle is a sent one. And I mentioned this before. Basically, even though, you know, we're not talking about, you know, all the gifts of the Spirit and all this kind of stuff, but, you know, when you operate in the authority of, like, a missionary, it's a great example of, you know, apostolic authority and going to an unreached area like the apostles did, you know, giving the gospel, evangelizing, then, you know, laying hands on people and anointing them, oh, you know, and telling them, hey, God is calling you to be a preacher. We need pastors here. God's going to make you a pastor. God's going to make you an evangelist. Then train those people, raise them up, plant churches, all that, you know, the work of what a missionary would do in an unreached area. This is a part of what would be called an apostle, a sent one. That's what the word means, to be a sent one. Now, we're not talking about the, you know, spiritual authority and all that kind of stuff, and talking about the 12 apostles from the disciples of Jesus. I'm talking about outside that, you know, what we would describe as an apostle in the church. This would be some of their duties in, you know, dealing with people. And then, of course, evangelist does evangelism, a prophet does what I just told you. But lots of times people think about a prophet as, you know, given a word, which I've just went over, the gifts of the Spirit. But the Bible's already been written, brothers and sisters. We already have the Bible. So the main job of a prophet, even in the Bible, when you read the Bible, it's not all this prophecy is about this is going to happen, that's going to happen. You know, there are some of that scattered through the writings of Jeremiah, Elijah, and all those guys, the things they did, the prophets from the Old Testament too, and even in the New Testament, there's some prophets in there too, like Agabus. In the book of Acts, we see New Testament prophets who prophesied the Apostle Paul that he was going to be arrested and all this. The purpose of prophets is to call the church to repentance, to call the church to repentance. Like John the Baptist was the greatest prophet in the Old Testament. Jesus said there was never been a prophet in the Old Testament as great as John the Baptist. But he, John the Baptist, is the least, you know, is less than the least among the New Testament saints, he said, Jesus said. You know, John the Baptist, even though he was the greatest in the Old Testament, the least saint in the New Testament is greater than John the Baptist. Why? Because, of course, we're under the blood of Jesus. We're not under the Old Testament. We're under the New Testament. So across testaments, the purpose of a prophet is always to call people back to the heart of God, to God's purpose and mission for those people. So, as an example, in the Old Testament, the prophets would come and say, hey, Israel, you're getting into idolatry. You need to come back to the law. You need to start following the law and get rid of your idols. And you need to, you know, you need to do all the things in the law. Tithe. You need to go up to Jerusalem three times a year. All those things. A New Testament prophet, as an example, is supposed to be the ones doing revivals, would go to a church. See, just like in the Old Testament, the establishment doesn't accept the right teaching. They don't want to hear that. They say, oh, we're doing this. We're doing our own thing. We're building our own kingdom here. And we don't want to be shaken up. We don't want to be waking up. We don't want to hear it. But a modern day New Testament prophet goes to a church and says, hey, you know, tells the pastor, God raised you up, pastor. Remember the original vision that the Lord gave you when he sent you here to this city? As an example, to Dallas, Texas, wherever. God sent you here and he wanted you to do inner city ministry and evangelize inner city people and have an interracial church. And he wanted you to establish that here in the city of Dallas and bring racial healing to the city of Dallas bring, a ministry to homeless people, whatever is the word that the Lord had originally raised up that pastor to do. And the pastor has strayed from that. The church has become a mega church and all this fancy stuff. And then God is calling him back to the foundation. As an example, let's look at an example, Joel Osteen. You know, you don't have to be a prophet to know that his dad, if you know anything about him, his dad was a mighty man of God. And now Joel Osteen's got into all this tree-hugging stuff and went way out of bounds where the Lord raised that ministry, that church was planted on a firm foundation, and now it's way over left field. So if God were to send someone like myself to Joel Osteen, it would be saying, hey, remember, God is saying this is the root and the base of this ministry. And you're over here, and you're way over here. You're out of bounds. You're way off track. In other words, someone who's in the office of a prophet, God shows them things the way they're supposed to be. That's the simplest way of saying it. The prophetic ministry says, from the Spirit of God, God shows the prophetic preacher, you know, this is the way things are supposed to be in this church or in this city, you know, or in individuals. You know, when the Lord would use me to minister to individuals, you know, the Lord calls those things that are not as if they are. You know, he told Abram, who was childless, 75 years old with no children. His wife was 65 years old beyond childbearing years, and they were too old to procreate. And God said, hey, I'm changing your name to Father of Many Nations, to Abraham. God speaks what's going to be and what's supposed to be. And that's really what the voice of a prophet does. It's not really about predicting the future, not a psychic prediction, but saying what God sees and what God says and what God is going to make happen. That's what the office of a prophet is. So in that role, brothers and sisters, as you know, someone had asked me about this because I've been doing missionary work and I've operated as a pastor. But my original calling and always has been and always is, because God's callings are without repentance, the Bible says, is that of an office of a prophet. I've always been doing that. It's never said it. You know, the fruit is self-evidence. You know, when I'm giving to people, ask me to give them a word and all that stuff, that is self-evident fruit. It's not just the gift of a word of knowledge. It's something that's not, you're not doing it every day. But if you're in the office of a prophet, God, by his grace, would allow you to do that on a regular basis because that's the office that you're called to. And so the preaching that I do lines up with that same topic, a call to repentance and revival in the church. And that's really what a true prophet is, not being a psychic. And that's where people have got that all mixed up with what's going on in the world. And then there's other people say, oh, if you're a prophet, then, they seem to think all these grandiose things about Elijah and all those guys. It tells us in James that Elijah ran away in fear and trembling. It's, you know, in James, it said, you know, it talks about that Elijah was a righteous man. It says the prayer of faith, the fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. When you're talking about anointing people with oil, it talks about that in James chapter 5. And it says Elijah was like us with like passions. You know, if you go back and read the story of Elijah after he called down fire from heaven and had all the false prophets of Baal destroyed, killed, then when Jezebel threatened him, Jezebel was the wife of King Ahab, when she threatened him, he ran and hid. And it was a little crybaby. You know, Lord, I'm the only one left. Nobody else cares. You know, and that's, and he you know, he stumbled. Just like Peter denied the Lord. You know, but Peter was an apostle, not a prophet. But the same type of thing. People are only humans. So people have delusional ideas of who these prophets were. They were not perfect. They made many errors. We see Jonah. Jonah wanted the people of Nineveh to die. He didn't want them to be delivered by God because they were such wicked people. They had, you know, they would gouge out the eyes of their enemies. They'd, you know, been cruel to the Israelites. So when God told Jonah, go there and preach repentance, he didn't want to because he wanted them to die. So we see that, you know, you can look all through there and see that the servants of God were not perfect. None of them were perfect. Moses made mistakes. All of them made mistakes, brothers and sisters. So, you know, when I just think about it, you know, this wasn't even the message I was going to talk about. Of course, the Lord always changes my message. It's so funny when people, you know, a false prophet is someone who, sets a date or gives a prophecy like that. Ephraim Rodriguez saying that asteroid is going to hit by the end of the year and everybody's going to die and all this stuff. It didn't happen. Okay, it's a false prophet. You know, someone that's, or someone like the founder of the Jehovah's Witnesses and the Mormons, Joseph Smith, that's a real false prophet. Someone that's leading, Muhammad, these are false prophets that are leading people away from Christ. That's definitely what we should be thinking about when we think about false prophets. Should be thinking about Joseph Smith and the Mormons, Jehovah's Witnesses and all these kind of things. Instead of looking for perfection in people, because when I read my Bible, Jesus was the only one that was perfect. Even under the law, Moses sinned against God. David even stole another man's wife who was a general in his army while he was in the battlefield, stole the man's wife, got her pregnant, Bathsheba, the mother of King Solomon. Then he even tried to get the guy to come home and sleep with his wife so he could cover up the fact he was the dad. The guy was so dedicated to his soldiers that he refused to sleep with his wife. So David told one of his other generals, hey, put him in the front so he'll get killed. He got the guy killed so that he would get Bathsheba and then, you know, to cover up his mistake or what he made. King David, who God said was a man after his own heart, and who did lots of prophecy. You're talking about somebody prophesied a lot. The book of Psalms, most of them are written by King David, and there's lots of great prophecies in there. King David was a man after God's own heart, but yet he committed adultery with another man's wife, had the man killed, and then took his wife, you know, one of his own generals. He was his boss. Took his wife to be his wife. So Uriah the Hittite is the guy's name. And Bathsheba ended up being the mother of King Solomon in the bloodline of Messiah, Jesus. And then here's King David, who God promised, you know, I'll raise up a seed. You know, your throne will endure forever. That's why they call Jesus the Son of David. And we see in the gospel people are calling him, you know, Jesus, thou Son of David, have mercy. You know, that's one of the titles they're saying for the Messiah. He's the Son of David. And here's David with all of his imperfections, all of his sins. You know, and this guy was a mighty man of God and the king of Israel and all this stuff. And God honored him so much, but yet he did those things. So it's laughable and hysterical that people are having this perfect standard that if someone, you know, I don't know what, you know, it's not me necessarily or other people, whomever. I hear people that someone makes a little mistake, then everybody, oh, he's a false prophet. Oh, you know, I don't agree with every single doctrine you said. Therefore, you know, you must be a false prophet. You guys, I'll tell you what, there's an old saying that says, don't throw rocks in a glass house. And I'm telling you what, you talk about people that's living in sin and walking in sin and then trying to judge other people. There's lots of people that don't live a sanctified life. And then, you know, that are living in sin, living with people they're not married with, all kinds of other things, all kinds of sins. And then, you know, trying to judge God's people. That's why I don't receive, you know, I don't receive judgment from man. I receive judgment from the Lord. I answer to the Lord. And each one of us, we need to answer to the Lord. Now, when we hear preaching like me, I mean, it's not like I call you up on the phone and say, hey, brother so-and-so, you know, I think what you're doing and blah, 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 blah. No. Now, that's different. I'm judging you. But when I'm preaching, like what I'm doing now, just in general for everybody, general truth, for myself included, all of us. Now that's something we need to listen to. When someone's preaching, we listen to that word proclaimed, not to us personally, but there are parts in there that is to us personally. From God, God is using that message for each of us to lead us in repentance and all those things. Now that's something totally different, brothers and sisters. But what I'm trying to get across to you is that following the Lord and trying to, and lots of you who follow my video are also in the prophetic. You know, God has called you into the prophetic area. It's not an easy road to hoe. As a matter of fact, it's a very hard place to be. You know, you don't fit in with the people, you know, but there's lots of people who are out there who, you know, who think God put them on YouTube to, you know, attack everybody, run everybody down. And they're the ones that's from the devil. They're the ones that try to discourage people or trying to do something for God. Not only me, there's lots of people. You know, like myself, you know, just mentioning myself. You know, God is using me to do these orphanages in the Philippines and the feeding programs and all that. And then the Lord has used me. You know, I am an ordained minister to make videos and teaching about rapture and tribulation and all that. And it's helped lots, hundreds or thousands of people have contacted me. They've been blessed. But then you get those little demons, little demon-used people used by the devil, perfectionists, Judaizers, or whoever, whatever you want to call them, who are, themselves are living in sin and trying to throw, you know, darts at everybody. You know, like Minister Paul, you know, he's had lots of trouble with people doing that to him also. You know, and what I'm saying for you guys, I ignore them. I'm saying for you guys, ignore them. Ignore them. The Lord is our judge. Look to the Lord to be your judge. Judge yourself by the word of God and by his spirit and not by what, you know, all these, you know, trash talkers are doing and all those kind of things. You know, be led by the Spirit. Those who are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. Romans chapter 8, verse 14. Go by that, brothers and sisters. Don't go by what people say and do. You don't be moved by that. By the grace of God, I try my best not to be moved. Every once in a while, I get a little bit upset, but I pray about it. Boom, come back. I'm not moved by it. These things don't move me, brothers and sisters. You got to be, you know, you got to stick on the path that God put you on. God bless you guys. See you soon.